Okay, people, it is something like October 24th, probably at like 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. Anyway, I'm working on the drum bag. This is the bottom of the bag. Here it is. It's a square. Hold on. That's as small as it will go. Well, it's a rectangle, right? It's the bottom, so you kind of want it a little thicker, right? This is just an old pad of some kind that I had kicking around. Well, it's not old, but something I never threw out that's actually working out pretty good, because I was going to put an interfacing, because that's the bottom, but it needs to have a little strength to it, so you'd want some sort of an interfacing. I don't have the interfacing that I want, but this actually works in my favor, this mat, because not only do I have the plastic to preserve it from water, to protect it from water, in case the bottom of the bag goes on the ground and there's water, it's sure the water may absorb into the fabric, but there will be a layer of plastic, then a layer of foam to give it that base. I'm taking off this part, or I could turn it around and keep that on. It's very thin, it wouldn't really matter. I suppose I could do that. We can do it this way. Alright, so you've got the fabric, the water protection, which this one would actually be better, and then the foam, and then you would put this one over top of it. Alright, and then you'd serge it so the fabric doesn't run, and then you'd crisscross it so nothing in there puckers, and then that's gonna go on the inside of the bag, and then the drum will sit on that so it has some cushioning. That's piglet poo. It's Andre's old bumper pads for his crib, and then I'm gonna layer it in the bag and put the drums in between. Okay, so do you see that? So what I've done, bottom fabric, well, actually, doesn't really matter. This is the bottom this way, right? Bottom fabric, there's that plastic, there's that foam. There wasn't enough of that black fabric, but that's okay, don't really need it anyway. And then there's the fabric, right? And then what you're gonna do is after you've done that, you're going to draw your lines however you want. You can go whichever way. And then stitch it so it just makes it a little so this stuff doesn't pucker as it's being moved around. And then that will be the base of the bag. And then from there we're going to build up. Okay, people. So now I'm outside. We'll get back to that drum bag later. Can you see this tree? My neighbor was saying that somebody actually brought this tree here and dropped it off in here. How they got it in here, who knows? But anyway, it works for me because it gives me some, it gives me some nice pine needles. So hold on.
What?
Okay, what you gonna say?
We got rocks.
Uh-huh, and what else do we got?
Bricks.
A brick, one brick, only one brick. And then all, what's inside the bucket?
And, I don't know.
What are these?
What?
What are these?
Pecker bush?
No, you know what it is.
What are they?
Pine needles.
Pine needles.
Yeah, we're collecting pine needles.
Yeah.
It's for mulch for the yard. Are you holding the camera?
Yep.
Okay, show how much we got off the tree.
One.
Yeah.
Two.
This is, how many buckets have we done so far?
One.
Two buckets, people. That's our second bucket. Okay, we'll be back.
Nope.
Okay, people, so that's the strawberry patch. I'm going to work a little bit in here just to clean it up because winter is coming, right? Here's that celery that's in the ground. Like I said, didn't really grow. I don't know. But that's okay. It's good for soup, whatever. I'll probably take some out, put it in the greenhouse.
Now talk about this.
Oh, what are you doing?
Take out the water.
You're taking out the water. Okay, not the mud. Don't put the mud on the ground. okay? Because the mud I can empty back into here after I take out some stuff, okay? Yeah, but not on the leeks. Don't put it on the leeks, because now it's going to take out some of those leeks and put them in the greenhouse. Okay, we want the wheelbarrow to get rocks for the pond for next year, so. Andre's quite the hard little worker. Are you getting strong, Andre?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, we'll be back, people. Okay, people, so I'm in my sewing room now. I have this, yeah, this was like a, some sort of a bed cover. It had a little brown frill on it. It will make for a good interfacing to kind of, again, give some stability to this drum bag, because I'm in, obviously, in my sewing room, right? So we're going to line the outside with some interfacing, and then I may use that for the inside. And then these will be attached within layers. So, hold on. Okay, so I just want to point out how big my workspace is here. It's not very big, people. Like, that's not even 2.5 feet. This way. And this is less. This is the lining. It's a corduroy. Okay, so I just wanted to point out that the pile on this is going down. And if you notice, I cut it, right? I'll put a seam in the middle. And then the one that goes over the drums will not have a seam. It will be just one piece of fabric. But the lining, the pile has to go down, right? Has to go down the fabric. So. Okay, people. It's the next day.
Right.
Well, it's the same day because I was sewing, what, at 3 o'clock this morning, right? Anyway, this fabric here is going to be made into some do-rags. And it's going, I'm going to send a batch, just a small batch, not of all this, but other fabric as well, right? But this one in here in particular, 3 of them are going to California as a little test project. But before I do that, as you can see, people, this sewing room just doesn't have no room. I have to go downstairs and clear off the table down there, but I'm not up to going downstairs right now. So I wanted to, the people that from California that are watching my channel, that know that I'm, you know, trying to bring in some programs for homelessness and food security and all that other stuff, right? That do understand that I do work on a legit nonprofit, even though it doesn't seem like that sometimes, right?
Right.
Right. This fabric here is intended for you and your buddies. Okay? And then, but before that can go on, I really need to get up and work on this drum bag. But I have some YouTube stalkers that are connected somehow to my stepdad that are harassing me personally and trying to sabotage my channel. So, besides that point, we're going to get back on the drum bag. Hold on. Okay, people. So, I'm trying to do this as fast as I can. There you go. You got your outside of the fabric. You've got your interfacing. And then this will be the lining. So first you do, you sew the bag, the outside. Oh, give the camera a minute here. sew the outside of the bag together, make box, or whatever you're going to make. In this case, it's not a box, but you'll see what I'm going to make. And then sew the inside, and then put, you'll see, hold on, back to back. Okay, so moving along, right, you can see I stacked them up. Now I'm going to take that. And I'm going to put it over that, and we're going to start piecing it together. Hold on. Okay, as you can see what I've done here, right, laid it around. Here's the inside. This is the lining. Pinned it in there. I'm going to stitch it now. And hold on. Okay, so as you're working on the lining, right, don't forget to top stitch, because this is a drum bag that's carrying a lot of weight, right? So it's going to be moving and stuff, so you want to reinforce the seam. And also, too, this interfacing will protect from this fraying, right? You can see the fabric is fraying. So, okay, so you can see what I'm doing now, right? Sewed it, top stitched it on, right? And now we're going to take... nice of fabric and do it over this, right? And then sew it separately and then put it over. But I still have to add trim along the bottom. And I got to decide what kind of zipper I want. Hold on. Okay, so this is where we're at. So as you can see, I've done that. I'm a little short, but I already knew I was because I didn't have enough fabric. But I've got this here, so we're going to add the base all the way around. Quiet, it has to go all the way around. Zipper will probably come up from the side. Go up, wait, hold on. Go up, around, oh, sorry. And then it will probably stop right there. And then these things will just pull out. That's the idea. So I have to put some handles on it too yet. Okay, so this is the part I'm going to use for that little trim on the bottom. But because the fabric frays, you want to reinforce it with, I can't remember what this stuff is called. But as you can see what I'm doing here, right? Hold on. Okay, cool. As you can see.
Michelle came out first.
Put that on there. Yeah, members and friends. Then I'm going to top stitch it on along here.
Right.
You can see. And then somehow put the bottom on. But in the meantime, Andre and I are going to go make some bread. Bread is very expensive. Went to wanted to make some hamburger buns, right? Like make hamburgers. Went to go buy some buns yesterday and it was like $4 for like 8 buns and I'm like, to heck with that. Can't afford that, people. Hold on. Okay, so I'm in the kitchen now. It's 2:45 in the afternoon. I bought this little appliance in a thrift store. I paid something like $40 for it. Apparently it makes bread. It has a little blender too. It's an old school. There's an attachment that I don't have. But this is also a grinder too. You can turn it over and it can grind things. But there's an attachment that you can grind wheat with, but I don't have that part. But in terms of a receipt that came for this, back in the day, I don't know how old this is. This thing is, it's probably like in the 60s or 70s or 80s or something. It was like $845. Can you believe that, people? Like $845. Like I got the original receipt for it, right? And if you look online for something similar, these things that can sell up to like $400 or $500. I don't know about $800 anymore, but anyway, I'm going to try and make some bread with this machine because that's what it's meant to do, basically, right? And then of course I cut my rosemary down, right? Because it's getting cold out there. So I'm going to have to put that in a dehydrator or turn it upside down. Probably just put it in a dehydrator. It's easier. So yeah, we'll be back. Hold on. Okay. So we're starting this now.
Show me.
I don't know. As you can see, it's all foamy. That yeast, oh, it smells like yeast, people. It's very old. So I put an extra half a tablespoon in there, so 3 tablespoons instead of 2.5, but as you can see, it works perfectly fine. Right, and then it's 1 to 2 tablespoons of salt. I'm using Celtic salt, so I am just going to do...
I smell this.
1.5. Not quite 1.5.
Talk about this too.
This is shortening, milk is shortening, 1/2 cup.
Yep, and that's shortening.
So we'll just put that, oops, sorry, put that in there.
I smell it.
Hold on, can't you smell the yeast? And then 5 cups of flour.
And I glass got in there.
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know, 2, look at, I'm making a mistake. Ugh. 2, 3.
Go.
4.5. I guess you're supposed to put this thing on. Right. I don't know if you're supposed to put the lid on. I guess you're supposed to put the lid on. Oh, sorry. Okay. And then you turn it on one. And you let it mix for about 5 minutes. Anyway, I don't know. I have to read the directions again. I never used this machine before, people. So I'll be back. Hold on. Okay, there was another part that I had to add in there. Said mix it for 1 to 2 minutes until it's well blended, which it's done. And then start adding in your flour, another 4 to 5 cups. So that's what we're gonna do here. This is one right here. You see that? So there's 10 cups of flour in there. It said sticky, so it's kind of sticky, right? So now you put the lid on it, and then you put it on 2, and you blast it for 5 minutes there. Let it knead. So I guess it can lock. And then you put it on 2. And you do that for 5 minutes. Okay, people, so now it's out of that machine. It's definitely got a different feel to it.
Now we'll talk about this.
It's just a little bit of flour. It's not what I'm from. Yes, Andre. It's not what I'm familiar with, but I'm going to put it on the table here, and then I'm going to just knead it a little bit.
And I'm going to help.
And you're going to help. Did you wash your hands? No, you didn't. So go wash your hands. And then I'm going to make 2 loaves of bread and a few buns, or a few buns and 1 loaf of bread. We'll see. And one bread, I'm just going to take some of this dehydrated Swiss chard from 2014, and I'm going to knead it in there, in the bread itself. So hold on a minute. Okay, so what did you say? Tell the members and friends what this smells like.
It smells like bread.
And what is it? Is it just, you just said it smells?
Like bread.
Uh-huh, and it's?
It smells like... And we're going to make bread.
Yes, and it smells good, doesn't it?
I was to it.
Anyway, it's coming out of that machine pretty good.
Watch out.
I'm just kneading it a little bit here.
Yeah, and we're not going to roll it.
No, we're not going to roll this one. That's for apple pie, Andre. But for now, we're just going to do a little bit of kneading. I'm only kneading it lightly. It said put it in pans and let it rise and then bake it. I don't know. It must have been for, like, what do they call it when it's fast-rising yeast? I don't remember the yeast that's in my fridge in that jar. It's been there forever, people, probably about 7 years. I didn't use it all, but obviously it's still working. So hold on a minute.
It's supposed
to... Okay.
No.
So this is that Swiss chard. Just broke it up with my finger, actually. Right? And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to knead it in a little bit into the bread.
Okay, I'll do that.
I've got some old Parmesan cheese here, so we're just going to put a tablespoon or a teaspoon in a bit of Parmesan cheese just to give this one a little different flavor. We've got 1 loaf. I don't know how well this is going to rise. The dough is very manageable. I'm quite impressed with the dough itself. Right? You can see. We'll see how it rises, though. Hold on a minute. Okay, so I put it in the oven. Normally, I'd put a tray in there with hot water. Here, I just turned on the oven turned off the oven now. I'm going to cover it up with a cloth, let it sit and double, and then I'm just going to turn on the heat and bake it. And that was pretty fast. Okay, so that wasn't that hard with that machine. That was actually pretty easy for the one recipe that I did. That was just one recipe. So, didn't rise very much though, right? Maybe I should have stuck them together and it would have been a nice big loaf, so, right? Because I did a fair amount of buns here. The buns did pretty good. Anyway, Okay, so now we're putting on that lip at the bottom of the bag. Okay, here's the lining with the interfacing. You can see the inside seam is nice. This is called bias tape. I already put a trim on it. I'm lining it up and I'm putting, you can see, right, there's the seam. Oops, sorry. There's the seam, fold it over, put that over top. I'm using that as my guide. And then I'm gonna top stitch it on. Okay, so that's on now. Oops, sorry. You can see that. I think the way I'm gonna do this, this is where it's gonna start getting bulky and complicated. Pull it to its endpoints, pin it, stitch it, fold it up, and then take this piece and go under it with a hem, and then probably hand stitch it. And that will be the adding on the base. And then I have to make some kind of a strap yet. I don't know, this might be a very heavy bag with these drums. I know this drum down here is heavy. Not so much these ones. These ones aren't so heavy. But this is a different kind of wood. But we still have to do the front yet. You can see that, right? But before I do the front, I'm going to put on the base. Hold on. Okay, you can see what I've done. I had to cut it in this way. I only had so much of this fabric here, people. Right. So I'm going to sew it 1/4 inch. Right. Or so. I'll trim that off. And then, like I said, I'll probably take this one, fold it over, and then if I can't do it by machine, I'll do it by hand, and then the base will be on. Hold on. So as you can see what I'm doing, just going along with the sewing foot there, and then I'll trim this part off, right? Okay, so I just realized I made a mistake, but I'm not picking this part. I didn't leave 1/2 inch, at least, this last panel, but that's okay. Okay, so now that that's done, this is what you're gonna get. Okay, and you're gonna lay that out flat, pin it. Oh, jeez, it's hard to do this. All right. Hold on a minute. Okay, so I pulled out this sleeve arm thing to put your sleeves in. But before I continue on folding this over and then doing a top stitch, probably, if I can do that by machine, I don't have an industrial machine, so when you get into this and it's big and bulky and the fabric's thick, it's hard to run it through the machine. But outside of that, I'm pretty sure I can do a top stitch just to reinforce the one thread line, right? So if it breaks, you have a second one. Maybe even a zigzag, because it is at the bottom of the bag. And the more rigid the base is, the more it's going to stand up to the wear and tear of being moved around, right? So, you get the idea, because this is the bottom of the bag. And then on the inside, you've got one layer of plastic, right, in case the bag goes on something wet. Then you've got the interfacing, In this case, it's a little bit of a sponge, and then it's got the cover. So, hold on. Okay, so now the next step is, you can see, is to put it on that arm, make it taut, fold it over, and like I said, I'll probably, you know, fold it over twice, pin it, and then I'll probably just do it by hand. And then we have the straps. And the last panel. Okay, so as you can see, folded it over, gave it a hem, folded it over, like right, and I'm pinning it. I'm going to try and run it through the machine. If not, I'll have to sew it on by hand. Okay, so far I'm okay, but I'm coming in around the corner here. That's when it starts getting funky. Because all these pins, right? I'm poking at you. You got pins everywhere. Okay, so going around the second time, oops, is not that difficult. So you want to go around twice. This is at the bottom of the bag, right? Do you see that sewing machine, people? I'm sewing, right? And I'm thinking. And like, Uncle John bought me this sewing machine. Oh. Like, almost 24 years ago. Seriously, I've had this thing for that long. And it still sews pretty good. It's a little screechy, but it has a dog feed dog on it, and you can drop in the needle, so it works really, really good. I've sold many things on this, people. Okay, so far so good. I think turned out pretty good. It's pretty solid. You can see, doesn't even look that bad, right? The purpose of the bag is just to protect the drums from being moved around and nicked and dropped and scratched and things spilt on it and stuff like that, right? So, hold on. Okay, so the idea is, you see inside the bag? Right? It's these bumper pads with little ties on them. Right, so where is that? There it is. So I will sew that on, and then I'm going to do it in layers so that the drums just go in between. Okay, so now I'm making straps, just two of them, almost out of fabric, not much left, and I'm going to try it this way, of course, interfacing, because it's a strap, you're going to be using it all the time, right? Sew it. Take a safety pin, obviously a large one, hook it on, go into this, and start pulling the fabric out. Hold on. Okay, so I'm getting pretty tired here. So after you put your little seam on, don't make it too big. That's what, 1/8 of an inch, it's not very big, right? Half of a quarter, right? Try and get it as much as you can, but not too much, because you won't be able to get your safety pin through, because after you sew it, you hook on your safety pin, right? You hook it on, and then you go into it, and then you just pull the fabric out. This is what you get. Worked fine. You center your seam in the middle of the fabric, you press it down as best as you can. You can see what happens then. So your seam is in the middle, and then you give it a top stitch on both sides to reinforce it. And there you go. And look at this big bag of Mr. Lace's feathers. That's all his feathers, people. And he got attacked by that raccoon. Okay, people. We're going into the greenhouse.
I was going to talk inside.
I haven't been in here for a few days.
Oh, I don't see your gloves.
Hmm?
I don't see your gloves.
You don't see my gloves?
Nope, not yet.
But when was the last time I was in here? I don't think the tomato plant made it.
Poor right. Tomato plant.
That's taking root. Oops, sorry.
Oh, I don't want to hold it.
Don't drop it. What yep. You gonna say? Move your fingers. You know, you gotta move your finger off the lens. Okay.
Yeah.
Talk.
This is tomato plant.
Mm-hmm.
And this is
parsley.
Parsley.
Swiss chard.
Parsley again.
With that down there. Don't drop the camera. He's got the camera by himself, people.
Where's this?
Yeah, come stand back. Come over here. Hold the camera down. I think we're on this. Yeah. There you go. Don't just whatever you do, don't drop it, Andre. Oh my. You got it? Hang on to it. Hang on to the strap. What is that? Celery.
Celery.
Yeah. Okay, people, so we're going back to the tree. Right, Andre?
Yep. I talked outside.
Uh-huh. Anyway.
Let's talk outside now.
We'll be back. Okay, as you can see, getting more pine needles. All right. Okay, people. Do you see those little purple flowers?
Yeah, whoa. Talk about me.
And what's Andre doing?
No.
What are you doing, Andre?
Getting toys.
Getting toys, eh?
I think we're muddy.
Yeah, I think you should get your jacket on.
Why?
Because it's cold. And this one's blooming little white ones. Do you see that? Little purple ones.
Get out.
I got flowers all over the place still growing. And there's some flowers over there. Do you see? And the flowers over there. Right. Flowers over there.
Now look, I got a boat.
Yeah.
Talk about my boat.
Where's your boat?
Oh no, my boat is sinking.
Uh-huh.
Why is it sinking?
I don't know.
It's not funny.
Anyway, I'm harvesting some food as usual, right? This is a herb that Japanese people like to use. So I'm going to cut some leaves off and spray them down and dehydrate them and put them in a jar. And I got some beet leaves over here. I'll show you in a bit. Hold on. Okay, so I'm just going to end this video with these beets. Right? This is a little patch of beets that I had. They didn't get a lot of sun. But that's okay. They grew. Right? You can see. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to shred them, chop up the stems and leaves, and I'm going to freeze them all together as is, because I wanted to buy a 25-pound bag of beets. But, of course, I have no money, right? And 25-pound bag of carrots, shred everything, package them up into little bags, and then you freeze them like that, and you can use it for soup, right? In this case, it would be for borscht. So I'm just going to upload what I have now. As for the drum bag, I don't think I'm going to sew on it tonight because I was outside and it's cold and I'm tired. And I got some things I have to obviously do these. So I probably won't, it'll probably take me a couple more days to finish that drum bag. So next video, we'll be working on the drum bag.